no secret that Australia's and South Australia's health system is facing many challenges. The need to improve economic performance and productivity of the system is one that is well recognised. Whether you are considering the state public health system, the national aged care system, or individual private hospitals, the need to manage the difficult financial circumstances is a common thread. Too often we think that regressive and negative cuts are forced onto the table in the absence of any alternatives. The ANMF has, in recognising the financial and other challenges facing the system, attempted wherever possible to approach the debate with the objective of obtaining agreement to what we call positive reform or change. Taking this approach is risky. It would be much easier to simply remain critical of decisions that we don't like or want. It also means that we have to invest time and resources in the development of solutions to the problems that we all face. In Australia, we have seen the spasmodic issuing of evidence-based approaches to issues, hand-washing, pressure ulcer prevalence and prevention, falls reduction strategies, and alternative management of restraint, just to name a few. In most cases, they have been top-down campaigns by national or state bodies seeking to achieve system-wide change, rather than approaches developed by health services as a local level. This approach has meant that, in many cases, health services have responded by implementing the guideline or new practice required by the policy change, but there has been little investment in its translation into practice and embedding these changes within local culture or in spreading that implementation work beyond the issue in question. These are some of the reasons why we were struck by the work of the Registered Nurses Association of Ontario during a visit to Canada over 5 years ago. The Registered Nurses Association of Ontario has, as others have done, developed a series of International Best Practice Guidelines, or BPGs, to support nursing and midwifery practice. However, they have taken the development of these guidelines to a new or different level than in most other systems. The RNAO's BPGs and supportive toolkits succinctly capture the evidence based on a rigorous and robust methodology. The BPG and BPSO programs are now used heavily in Canada, but they are also growing as an international movement, having been adopted in Spain, Chile, the US, Colombia, to name a few, and of course, now in Australia, thanks to a pilot grant from the SA government. The ANMF firmly believes that this program is part of the solution to health system performance and health financial performance. But don't just take my word for it. You'll now hear from those who have driven the BPSO program at the coalface, at the Central Adelaide Rehabilitation Service and Northern Adelaide Local Health Network, where the program is being rolled out in South Australia.
So we chose Nahlen to be part of the BPSO program in South Australia because of what we thought it could contribute to enhancing patient care. It's about also looking at the work that we were currently doing with our national safety and quality standards and actually ensuring that the work of the BPSO will complement that work and actually bring the two aspects of both programs together to actually get the best outcomes for patients.
Well, we'd heard a lot about the BPSO, so I went on to the website and was just amazed by everything that was on there and the client-centeredness of everything. So then when we were sort of given the opportunity to be a BPSO candidate, it was a no-brainer. We were sort of heading down the path of wanting to go very client-centered, and that we were sort of feeling that a lot of the client-centered care was going out of nursing. So this was a perfect opportunity, and that all the tools were there. So we thought, great, we'll just do it.
Being able to bring the focus back to being patient-focused, about the patient within the whole service delivery model that we have within the organisation, and that it also empowers the nurses and the midwives in the clinical units to actually reflect upon the practices that they've got and to identify ways by which they can actually improve their own individual approaches to client-centred care or patient-centred care, but also how to identify where there might be deficits and where they can improve upon those and to actually take their colleagues on that journey as well.
To actually had the clients more involved in setting up the way the system is ran, the programs that have ran to help them, is going to make the clients more satisfied.
Just the, I think, questioning of what the nursing goals are and how to best achieve those, and I guess best for client outcomes and best for nursing practice, I guess, working smarter and not harder, I think.
We all think we're client-centred. I think it's just really pushed it right to the front, and I think that I look at it from a different view now, that it is about my client and what they want and how the care is delivered. It's not about how I think it should be delivered. It's about listening to them, engaging with them and negotiating, I suppose.
The most important thing I think we've seen change is culture. You know, just the language, the way people talk about patients. You know, we had a really good example the other week where I was watching the girls on the ward and they looked like they were having a bit of a heated discussion, and this one nurse was very upset because a patient had told her that you don't respect my dignity, you don't treat me with dignity. And she was hurt by it, and also, you know, very sort of, oh no, we do. And one of our champions that had been through the client-centered care workshop, you know, she sort of stepped in and she said, okay, why don't we go ask the client what they think that we could do to help with their dignity. And within 2 minutes it was all sorted out, you know, and that was something that you wouldn't have seen before, you know, going and asking the client, well, how do you want us to fix this?
To translate, you know, evidence-based practice into everyday interactions and so forth is really, really difficult. If you don't have all the elements coming together, all the components of, you know, education, organisational support, reflection of policies and procedures, and sustainability. So the BPSO program actually gives you all of the elements already. You know, you have your toolkit, you have the BPG that sits next to it, so that you absolutely do not skip or forget a step in that whole process, and it ensures that you are successful if you use that toolkit.
It encourages you to reflect on your practice. It encourages you to reflect on your interactions with not only patients but staff. It promotes respect and dignity for everyone involved in healthcare.
I can remember hearing all this buzz about this new BPSO program that was starting, and you know, hearing that it was around evidence-based practice, and I have to admit I was a little bit cynical when I first heard about it. Another change, you know, another change in process, but actually the more I got to hear about it, the more I thought, wow, this isn't just about a change of process, this is about a whole philosophy, and you know, the fact that it came from the top down and the bottom up.
We've had a lot of benefits. You know, our restraint data has shown that, you know, our code blacks are going down. Our falls data has shown. So you've got those direct patient outcomes. I think you've also got, to me, we've seen the culture in the staff of starting to look at, well, is that best practice? Mm-hmm. Whereas an older facility, a lot of the staff have been here for a long period of time, so it used to always be, well, we do it that way because we always have, you know, where now they are actually starting to question, is it best practice? And they're not scared now to pick up a best practice guideline and have a look, you know, and they know where they are on the internet.
Probably the only way I could describe it is, if you've got to go through an injury like my wife went through, Cheryl, back in 2006, it was great, but the system is so much better today. If we could actually do a time warp to now, I'd love her to be in the program today instead of 2006. But that's not saying back in 2006 the system was bad. It's just a lot better now. The engagement is so much better. And you know, I think that family feeling that we had back then would be even greater now.
I certainly would recommend the BPSO program to other colleagues. I think it really gives you that framework you need. It gives you that the goalposts to go through. Often we've got a million and one good ideas for improvement, but if you don't tie them all together, you can't sustain them. And you also can't have them dependent on one person. So with the champions model that the BPSO uses, it makes sure that you do impart that knowledge on the clinicians actually delivering the care, and then they can transfer that knowledge to the next person.
I would absolutely recommend the program to another LHN. I think that initially with any new program, it can seem quite daunting what you need to do, you know, how you have to harness the workforce, how does this work, what does this mean, and is it going to be extra work? I think that the funding we've received to enable a resource person and a project person to come in and assist us with that has been invaluable. But I think that when people can start to see that what we're attempting to do will enhance nursing and midwifery care practice and then translate that into better patient outcomes, nothing breeds success like success.